welcome you all to the service tonight. We're going to ask that you bow with us. We will make a custom of commencing our service with a moment of silent prayer. Will you pray with us? Scripture says, let us come before his presence with singing. Number 41, the special evangelistic songbook that you have. Is it gray or green? I'm not sure. It's page 41. All hail the power of Jesus' name, let angels prostrate fall. Bring forth the royal diadem and crown him Lord of all. A great hymn of the church. I'm going to ask that we stand as we sing. In Jesus Christ, in the Christian faith, and the power that is beyond even our comprehension or understanding when we realize how great Almighty God is. I think that perhaps some of us are just a little bit reticent to sing out sometimes when we're in church, and perhaps the best singing that we do is at home when we're by ourselves. And when we think no one is listening. Now, I want you to relax, to enjoy yourselves, and enjoy the service. And you will get out of the service just what you put into it, whether it's singing or whatever we're doing. And I want you to feel at home and to become just a part of the church for the evening, though this may not be your home church. And be friendly, and you can even smile if you like. In fact, I tell you what, I think some of you are just a little bit, perhaps, not feeling quite at home tonight. We want all of you to feel at home. And I want you to turn to the person next to you and say to them, you're very sweet. I think maybe in this way you might smile. Would you do that? Good. All right. Now, that's better. Much better. I think that's going to be fine with just about everyone except one fellow who didn't turn to his wife. Let's sing the last stanza. Let every kindred, every tribe on this terrestrial ball to him all majesty ascribe and crown him. Sing it triumphantly. Crown him Lord of all. Last stanza, number 41. Singing together. So much better. Before you be seated, would you turn around and shake hands with at least three people? Tell them that you're glad to be here, and that you're glad that they're here. Would you do that? And then be seated, if you will. Fine. And then will you turn with me to number 38? Here's a well-known song that I'm sure is familiar to all of us. There's a land that is fairer than day, and by faith we can see it afar. There are no strangers here now. We're all acquainted. So you can completely relax and say, 38.
Fine cooperation that we're receiving from the other churches. We know that as the week progresses, that more and more will be with us. We're prepared after the service tomorrow night, if it's necessary, to go out to the State College football field and have the services out there. And that will be determined by the service tomorrow night. We've got a wonderful group here tonight. Your presence. Now we have the pastor of the Calvary Presbyterian Church, Reverend Graham Spurrier, and he's going to lead us in our prayer. Eternal Father, thou art the great God. Beside thee there is no God. We thank thee for the revelation that thou hast given to us of thyself in the person of Jesus Christ. We remember his word, he that has seen me has seen the Father also, for I and the Father are one. We thank thee for the coming of Christ into this world and for the purpose of his coming. But we know that he came to seek and to save that which was lost. And unless a person, our Father, realizes that he is lost, he will see no need of Christ. How we praise thee for that happy day when so many of us came to realize that we were lost, lost in sin, and needed Jesus Christ, the Savior of sinners, and placed our faith and trust in him. We give thee praise for the gospel, which we know is the power of God and the salvation to everyone that believes. We thank thee today for the power of Christ to save unto the uttermost all who come unto thee by him. We beseech thee most earnestly, our Father, that many shall come unto thee by Jesus Christ in these people, that there shall be great joy in our midst as we see sinners come to the Savior, repent of their sins, and receive him by faith to be personal Savior and Lord. We pray that backsliding shall be reclaimed, that the work of the Lord shall be greatly advanced through this crusade. We give thee praise for thy servants who are with us. We ask thee to anoint them with thy Holy Spirit. Fill them with thy Spirit. Fill them with thy message for our hearts, and enable them to give thy truth in the power of the Spirit to the glory of him who loved us and redeemed us in his own precious blood. Thy prayer is in his name, for his dear sake. Amen.
I should like to take this opportunity tonight to add my own word of welcome to each of you that is with us. And it is indeed a thrilling sight to see so many that have come on this first evening service to be with us. We hope that you'll plan to return just every night that you can. We've had a very warm and cordial welcome already in these first 24, a little more than 24 hours that we've been here, and you've made us feel a real part of the city. And if we can just have some sunshine now in the next few days, but I understand you want the rain, so we'll compromise, and if we can have it by the middle of the week anyway, that'll be fine. But we're delighted to see many of you that have come as visitors from other churches, and some of you from outside Johnson City tonight. How many of you folk come from outside the city and you've come to the service? Let's see your hands for just a moment. We want to welcome you. We have a large group. How many of you come from some other church than this church tonight and you're visiting? Let's see your hands. Good. We're glad to see you. How many folks are from this church? We do have some of you that came tonight too. If we didn't, I don't know what Dr. Wood would do. I've always been wondering, he has a little sense of humor here, just I'm a little bit afraid every time that he's introduced me, just what he's going to say. And I'm always wondering that, because I'm usually introduced, particularly outside of North America, as an American, and I have to make it very plain that I'm actually a Canadian. And though I live in the United States, I'm just a missionary over here. And I hope you appreciate that. My Canadian friends seem to like that better than you do. And then he said on television this morning that I was Billy Graham's brother-in-law, which happens to be true, since I married his sister. And someone asked me one time if I minded being presented in that way, and I said, no, I don't mind it at all. Because if I weren't Billy Graham's brother-in-law, I wouldn't be married to my wife, and that would be a tragedy. But I was speaking to the Junior Chamber of Commerce in Charlotte during the Billy Graham Crusade there, and Wade Sinclair of WBTV said that I was Billy Graham's sister-in-law when he introduced me. And I draw the line there. But, however, and the one thing I didn't say about Irv this morning that I mentioned to some of the folks last night is that Irv Chambers is a man of many talents. He's not only a wonderful musician and a preacher, but he's also a magician. And he can do a lot of tricks. As I said last night to a little group, the only trick I've learned to do is how to make a crowd disappear. But he does, now he's not going to pull any rabbits out of the pulpit or something like that, but for the young people he's been doing some of these magic tricks. And besides all of this, he's a bachelor. And we've been trying to find a wife for him every place we've gone now for years. And if we don't find somebody in Johnson City, I'm just going to give up. So I hope that we can work something out. But both of us are delighted to be here. And we come as ambassadors of Christ to present Him. And as Paul said, in Christ's stead, to say to men and women, be reconciled to God. Get right with God. I hope that in some senses can be the theme of this week we have together. Through Christ, to be reconciled to God by the reconciliation that Christ made when He shed His blood on the cross. And it is our prayer that during this week, many lives may be touched and you can have a part in this as you come. And I hope you'll not only come at night, but come in the morning. We're going to have morning services for just half an hour. And our first one will be tomorrow morning here at 7:15. Dr. Wood will have the details in a minute. But I hope you'll come, and I'm hoping you and the choir will come and sit up here in the choir in the morning and give us some support there. And you out here, come along and be with us at that time of the morning, and we'll try to wake you up with some coffee first if you come early. And we'll have a brief message. I'm going to bring a series of meditations this week on that great chapter, the 11th chapter of Hebrews, on the heroes of faith and the triumphs of faith. And you might read it tonight when you go home, and bring your Bibles when you come with you. You young people come at 7:15, and we'll have a way for you to get to school afterwards. And you businessmen come a little bit early, and this will be a wonderful way to start the day off together during this week, Monday through Friday. And then, of course, the evening services, and I hope that you'll spend time in prayer each day, and then come each night and bring your friends. And let's anticipate tremendous blessing that God, not some team that has come, but God, may do abundantly above all that we can ask or even think.
Tomorrow night, be here at the church at 6:45. Mr. Chambers and the others, we'd be happy to have you, and I think you'll get a big thrill out of singing with them. 6:45 each night, 45 minutes before the service begins. I presented Mr. Spurrier to you a few minutes ago. I wanted to tell you about the football game we had here the other night. We sent some boys from Knoxville back to Knoxville pretty sad. I picked up the Knoxville paper yesterday, and their account was in about five words, why they lost the game. It said in big headlines, too much Steve Spurrier. So we are proud of the boys. We've got one of our own boys, Jimmy Sanders, that's on the other end of the receiving line, and he played in the first game that they won the other night and caught those passes. So we are proud of our young people, and we're happy that so many of them are here tonight. We hope you're going to be in the services each night and in the morning services. Now, if you'll come at 6:45, we're going to have coffee and donuts And as I told you this morning, they're going to be the courtesy of our good friend Norton Arnie. And if you really enjoy doing something, you'll enjoy eating something that Mr. Arnie pays for. And we're really going to stick him this week. He's going to have the biggest donut bill he ever had. And coffee, too. He tried to get these donuts made square, you know, so he could put a little sign on each one. A square deal. He couldn't quite work that out. But he says he'll have plenty of donuts here and plenty of coffee. And Mr. Aldridge is going to be here to fix that coffee for us. He's got some helpers, I think, Dr. DeWitt and some of the others. So come at 6:45 and enjoy the fellowship there and the coffee. We'll be here in the sanctuary at 7:15. Then at 7:45, Mr. Ford will let you out so the youngsters can go on to school, so the men can go to work. Now, some have asked whether the other people, apart from the young people and the men, are invited. The answer to that question is yes, very definitely. We want any of you who can get up that early and be here to be with us. And if you don't get up that early and aren't with us, you just ought to be plain ashamed of yourself. So let's fill the sanctuary tomorrow morning. It isn't impossible. If you'll set your alarm clock tonight and get up in the morning and come, we can have a great group each morning to hear these great messages on the heroes of the faith. I can't think of anything that will be more thrilling. I can't think of a finer way to start the day. Come here to God's house in Christian fellowship, worship, and praise and prayer. We are confident this is going to be one of the greatest weeks in the history of Johnson City. We know that you've been praying for these services. We know that you're here tonight because you believe in your heart that you're going to see God at work this week. I'm sure that none of us are going to be disappointed. Think of someone that's not here tonight and bring them with you to the service tomorrow night. And nothing could rejoice my heart more than for us to have to leave the church here and go out to the football field. And to make this a great citywide effort on the part of all the ministers and all the churches as we get behind this great man of God. And as we implore our great God to do wonderful things through these his servants. Service tomorrow night is at 7:30. We sing in the choir, be here at 6:45. Counselors are asked to be here early each night in the junior department so they can help us with the counseling. And even though you haven't had this training, if you are a personal worker, if you know how to lead a soul to Christ, if you know how to open your Bible and sit down with a person and show them the truth of God's Word, then we want you to help us in the counseling if that help is needed. We're going to receive our evening offering, and we know that you Baptists and Methodists are much more generous than Presbyterians, and we're going to expect the biggest offering tonight we've ever taken in this church, because the Presbyterians seem to be outnumbered. You're not going to disappoint us, I'm sure. We recognize that these offerings will be used to take care of the expenses of the meeting and provide for the meeting. God has blessed you and want to express your gratitude in a tangible way, then this is an important part of our worship. We bring to our God our tithes and our offerings. May we receive evening tithes and offerings this time. Our Father, accept these our evening tithes and offerings. Bless them, sanctify them, use them for thy glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
47 in our songbook. Jesus, keep me near the cross, there a precious fountain, free to all a healing stream flows from Calvary's mountain. May I just make one more announcement concerning the choir? We would be happy to have any of you who would like to sing with us. Those of you who are 15 years of age or older, and if you can meet with us these nights at 6:45, we will be happy to have you come and meet with us tomorrow evening. Now shall we stand as we sing the first stanza only of this great gospel song. Shall we stand? Wonderful to know this Jesus Christ who gave us his life that we might have everlasting.
I walk at night beneath majestic skies, and all behind them is a God all wise, who pinned all stars each in a lonely place, then wrap them in the darkened robe of space. O Lord my God, how wonderful thou art to make our world and satisfy man's heart. With humbled pride before my God I bow. How wonderful, how glorious
time ago, there was a young minister walking down the streets of one of the great American cities. He was discouraged, disillusioned, ready to quit his ministry. Then he passed by a church, a busy corner. He looked up and he saw this sign on the side of it. It said, Jesus Christ is in this place. Anything can happen here. He walked inside. The church was empty. He went down to the very front. And there he knelt in a pew, alone with God. And he met his Lord again. He recommitted his life to it. He went out a transformed man. Jesus Christ said, where two or three are gathered together in my name, there am I in the midst. And tonight we are here in the name of Christ. That's the important thing. Not what men are here. Not what man is here. But Christ is here. Jesus Christ is in this place tonight. Unseen, invisible except to the eyes of faith, but just as really as the air we breathe is keeping us alive, though we can't see it, Christ is here. tonight he wants to come to your life. He wants to come into your heart to give you a new life, a new beginning, a new purpose, the forgiveness of sin. And I'm going to ask that, as will be our custom each night, we bow in prayer together and pray together this simple little prayer from our hearts. Lord Jesus, speak to me. May we pray that? Just that simple prayer. Lord Jesus, speak to me. Then we'll remain bound in a moment of silence as we open our hearts to listen for his voice within. This may be his night. You may not have come looking for anything. You may not have come anticipating anything. But this can be the greatest night in your life as you hear him. May we pray together then this prayer, Lord Jesus, speak to me. All together. Lord Jesus, speak to me. Lord Jesus Christ, we pray that thou wilt speak in the stillness of this night, in the silence of our hearts, through thy word, through thy spirit, through the experiences of others that we hear about. Bring us to a place of commitment. And may there be many who shall say to thee tonight, yes, Lord, what wilt thou have me to do? For we ask it in Jesus Christ's strong name. Amen. I'm going to ask you to turn in your Bibles tonight to the 9th chapter of the book of Acts. Acts chapter 9. And while you're turning, and I hope you will bring your Bible with you each night, there's nothing wrong with bringing your Bible to church. It's perfectly all right. And we'll let you do it. But I hope you'll get in the habit of doing it. And so bring your Bible when you come back tomorrow night. While you're turning to Acts chapter 9, if you don't have one, look on with your neighbor while we read. In the morning, if you are unable to come to the morning service, Irv Chambers is going to be on television with a song and a word at 7:45, right after he'll be here for our service. Then he's going to the TV station next door, whichever next door it is. And he's going to be bringing a devotional word on Mr. Arney's program. And then on Tuesday morning, it will be my privilege to be on after our early morning service here. So don't stay home to watch for that. That's no substitute for coming. But if you can't come, and tell your friends about it, and I hope they'll watch it too. Acts chapter 9. And we're reading tonight about one of the great conversion experiences of history. You know, there are many people who say evangelism is irrelevant to the burning issues of our day. They say, what's the sense? In a world in flames of having a meeting like this, and what difference could it make if a few people are converted? Well, here's an example. One man, his conversion, his life was changed, and many historians feel that our civilization as we know it is based very largely on this one man that we're going to read about tonight, who combined in his own life the Judaistic Hebrew tradition, and also the tradition of the Greeks. And these two are fused together in this man, and many historians would feel that it has contributed to our civilization as we know it in the West. And it started on this day when this man's life was changed. That's why I believe there are lives that are going to be touched. There are some of you young men, some of you high school students, some of you college students, whose lives are never going to be the same after this week. Not because I came here, but because Christ is here and Christ is speaking. You'll have a new direction. You'll look at things differently. You'll have a different set of values. The direction of your life will be reversed. Your little world, your sphere of influence can be affected, and you can affect decisions that are going to be made. And here we have this story. Acts 9, 1. And Saul of Tarsus, yet breathing out threatenings and slaughter against the disciples of the Lord, went unto the high priest and desired of him letters to Damascus to the synagogues, that if he found any of this way. Now, what way is he talking about? The Christian way. The early followers of Jesus Christ were called followers of the way. That was their name. They said they belonged to the way. Now, Jesus said, I am the way. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. That was the totalitarian, exclusive claim that Christ made. I am the way. I am the way to God. And Christ indicated that life is a pilgrimage in one of two directions, and you're going one of those two directions. He said there is a broad way, and it leads to destruction, and there are many people on it. Then he said there is a narrow way that leads to life, and few there be that find it. But he says we're on a way. In other words, the Christian life is a pilgrimage. It's not talk, it's walk. It's a commitment. You can't stand up in the stands as a spectator and watch others perform. We suffer from a disease called spectatoritis in America. Herb Elliott came over, the champion miler from Australia, and he looked at us in America and Canada, and he said, you're a nation, you're flabby. And we are compared to many other parts of the world. And one reason for it is because we have this spectatoritis. We sit at our television set and watch the game or up in the stands, but very few of us participate. And we have the same disease in the church. And there are many people who think that a Christian is a spectator who pays a minister to get up and perform. We just sit back and we enjoy it. That's not true. To be a Christian means to be committed to Christ, to be following Christ. Jesus said, get up and follow me. It means to be on the way. I want to ask, are you on the way tonight? Have you ever made this commitment? Has there come a time in your life when you've said yes to Christ? When you've said, Lord, I leave my sins. I turn from self. I come to thy cross. And I get up to follow thee. Have you committed yourself? If not, I'm going to ask you to do it during this week. And I'm going to ask you to do it tonight, to say yes tonight. Now, Saul was looking for followers of the way to persecute. And it says, on the way, as he journeyed, that if he found any of this way, whether they were men or women, he might bring them bound unto Jerusalem. And as he journeyed, he came near Damascus. And suddenly, there shined round about him a light from heaven. And he fell to the earth, and heard a voice saying unto him, Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me? And he said, who art thou, Lord? And the Lord said, I am Jesus, whom thou persecutest. It is hard for thee to kick against the pricks. Just like a horse with a goad, or an animal that's being goaded. He said, Paul, you're being goaded by the Holy Spirit in your conscience. You know you're not living right. And it's pricking you. And you're persecuting the Christian because you're reacting against this conviction of the Holy Spirit. Many of you perhaps are doing this. And he, trembling and astonished, said, Lord, what wilt thou have me to do? And the Lord said unto him, arise and go into the city, and it shall be told thee what thou must do. Now here was an encounter that this man had that was entirely unexpected. On the day when Saul of Tarsus, filled with hate, almost literally breathing out threats and slaughters against the followers of Christ, on the day when he left Jerusalem to go to Damascus, a journey that took about a week, he didn't have the slightest idea that before he ever got to his destination, he was going to meet Christ, and that encounter was going to change his life. But here he comes one noon, the sun at its zenith in the sky, and suddenly a light shines from heaven, and a voice speaks to him, and he falls down on the ground, and Christ encounters him. An unexpected encounter. And one thing that's been of tremendous interest as I have studied in the Bible and studied in people I have talked to, is how often conversion to Jesus Christ is an unexpected thing. People just don't expect it to happen. They don't see any need. They're not looking for anything. We've seen this in our crusades around the world. We've seen it in history. Now, there are many people who are seeking. There are many people who are looking for something. But on the other hand, there are some people who, when they come to Christ, it's unexpected. They never dreamed it would happen to them. There was a young fellow running away from God thousands of years ago. God had called him, and he said no. And he ran away. And then one day, as he was tending sheep on a hill, he turned around a little bend and looked up a valley, and there was a bush burning with fire, but it wasn't consumed. He drew near to see this sight, and a voice spoke to him and said, "Moses, this is holy ground." And that day his life was changed. It was unexpected. He didn't plan it. God planned it. There was a young medical man at the beginning of this century in the city of London, called out one night on an emergency call. And on his way back to his quarters, he passed by an auditorium where a team of American evangelists, Moody and Sankey, were holding evangelistic meetings. He wasn't religious, but he decided he'd go in simply out of curiosity and just to have a little fun so he would have he could tell some jokes about the meeting to the fellows back at the medical school. And he took the last seat that was left in the balcony and sat down. And a minister on the platform got up and began to pray, and he prayed and prayed and prayed, and he went on and on. And it seemed as if he was never going to stop. And this young medical student was so bored by it, because he wasn't a Christian, that he got up and started to leave. He said, "If this is all there is to it, I'm getting out." And just as he got up, the short, stocky American evangelist on the platform, D.L. Moody, got up and walked to the front of the platform and said, "Ladies and gentlemen, while this brother finishes his prayer, we'll all stand and sing a hymn." Well, this so shocked the young student that he sat back in his seat. And he listened to the simple gospel of Jesus Christ as D.L. Moody expounded it, as he'd never heard it before, that Christ died for his sin, that Christ would come into his life. And that night, young Wilford Grenfell was converted to Jesus Christ, and he became the great missionary doctor to Labrador. But it was unexpected. He wasn't looking for something, but God spoke to him. I remember in Sydney, Australia, when we were there in the Billy Graham Crusade in 1959, meeting in the showgrounds, and there was a salesman who came home one night. He'd been away all week, and he saw this great crowd, cars and buses, pedestrians by the thousands, hurrying toward the stadium. And he said to roll down his window at a light, and he said to a policeman, "What's going on?" And the policeman said, "Billy Graham's here tonight." And he said, "Billy Graham, oh boy." And he went home as fast as he could, and his house overlooked the Sydney showgrounds. And it was up on a hill. And he had a box seat to every sporting event that went on there. Never had to pay for it. He just bought himself a pair of field glasses. And he'd sit up in his second story window and look at the football game or the cricket game or whatever it was. So he ran home, went upstairs, threw open the window, got his spy glasses, and sat down, and he got the shock of his life. He thought that Billy Graham, the American boxer, was fighting there that night. And instead, here was this great crowd of thousands of people singing hymns, listening to the Word of God, and he sat there entranced. And at the end of the service, when Billy Graham gave the invitation to come and stand at the front and commit their lives to Christ in symbolism, and he saw those people coming, he put down his glasses. And he walked down to the first floor, and he walked out his front door, and all the way around the block to the entrance of the showgrounds, and he walked inside, and he stood by the platform with hundreds of others. And he gave his life to Christ. Unexpected. And I can't help feeling, on a night like this, at the beginning of a week like this, that there are some of us who are going to find our lives unexpectedly touched by God. You're not seeking consciously for anything. You're not anticipating anything. You didn't expect anything would happen. But some of you, before this service is over tonight, you're going to sense a still, small voice of the Holy Spirit. Not my voice. Not the voice to your physical ears, but the voice of the Holy Spirit taking the Word of God and applying it to your heart. And inside there will come a sense of need and a sense of longing. And Christ is going to speak to you and say, tonight, tonight, I want to give you eternal life. Tonight, I want to give you forgiveness. Tonight, I want to bring a new purpose into your life. You may be seeking for something. It may not be unexpected in that way. But perhaps you've been looking for a long time, and tonight will be the night that you'll encounter Him. And that day, when Paul had this unexpected encounter, several things happened. I just want to mention them briefly tonight. Because these things occur whenever there's a real conversion. Many people say, what is conversion? Christ said, except ye be converted, ye cannot enter into the kingdom of God. What happens when there's conversion? Well, first of all, he discovered an unexpected need in his own life. He heard a voice saying unto him, Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me? He didn't expect to meet God that day, but I'm sure if he thought that God would speak to him, he wouldn't have expected God to say what he did say. Because Saul was religious. He was a Pharisee of the Pharisees. Turn in your Bible tonight when you go home to the third chapter of Philippians. And you can read what Paul had to brag about, if you want to call it spiritual bragging, as far as his own personal, religious, and moral standing and accomplishment. Paul could look at the Old Testament and say, as touching the law, I am blameless. Hebrew of the Hebrews, Pharisee of the Pharisees, belonging to the strictest religious sect of the day, punctilious in worshiping and serving God according to the law of the Old Testament, he thought he was all right. Till on the day that he met Jesus Christ, a voice spoke to this good, upright, moral, religious man and said, Saul, why are you persecuting me? First time he saw his need. From that day on, Saul didn't stand in front of God and lift his head up and say, how good I am. He bowed his head and he said, Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am chief. His idea of himself changed completely. He had a revolution inside in his estimation of himself. Because for the first time, he started comparing himself with Christ. When he saw Christ, compared himself with Christ, not with other men, not with the other people that went to church, not with his neighbors, not with the fellows he went to the University of Tarsus with. But when he compared himself with Christ, when he looked into the blazing, scorching glory of God, suddenly he became conscious of how much he had sinned, and Paul wrote one day and said, all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. I wonder if you've ever had that experience. I wonder if you've ever stood in the light of Christ and taken your eyes off other men. You may look at other people and you say, I'm fine, I'm decent, I think I'll make it. I'm as good as, you say, I don't go to church, but I'm as good as the people that do. Or you may say, I go to church and I'm as good as the next member of the church. I'm moral, I'm decent, I'm upright, I don't hurt anybody. And you come off fine as long as the measuring rod is the standard of society around you. But that's not God's standard. God's standard is Christ. How do we compare to Him? I may think I'm pretty good at high jumping if I never put the bar above 2 feet off the ground. Put the poles out there and I put the pole across the standards 2 feet above the ground and I jump over it every time and I say, look what a great high jumper I am. I can jump it every time. Look at that. I think I'll apply for the Olympic squad. And you say, wait a minute now. John Thomas, you say, and some of these Russian fellows have jumped way up there about 7 feet 4 inches and you put the bar way up there and suddenly when I see what the world's record is, I realize I'm not such a good high jumper after all. I put the standard down here where men are, and it's one thing, but when I look at God's standard, suddenly I realize, as Paul did, the need in my life, and I cry out, "Oh God, be merciful to me, a sinner." Tonight in your heart, some of you, you're sensing this need. You say, "I need to be forgiven. I need to be changed." You confront Christ and you become aware of the inadequacy of your life. You thought you had everything you needed. You may be well off materially, secure, but suddenly you become conscious of an empty place in your night tonight, in your life tonight. Christ is speaking to you. This need is being revealed. And this is the first step where conversion takes place, where we become conscious of our need before a holy God to be right with Him. And nothing else matters except to know Him. And then Paul went on beyond that, because he not only discovered an unexpected need in his own life, but he discovered an unexpected truth. He gazed up into this dazzling light and he said, "Who art thou, Lord?" He thought he knew all about God before this, but suddenly he realized he didn't really know who God was. So he says, "Who art thou, Lord?" And the answer came back. And can you imagine how this must have shattered Paul? "I am Jesus, whom thou persecutest." The Christ he hated, the Christ he hounded, the Christ whose followers he was on the way to arrest, this Jesus was Lord, the Lord God. How it shattered his life. Who was God? God was revealed in Jesus Christ. That's what it meant to him. A young fellow said to me in Canada, "What do you think of when you think of God? What kind of a picture do you get in your mind? What kind of picture of a picture do you have when you think of God?" I think almost everybody has some kind of a picture in their minds. Now, what do you think of? Some people, I think, have pictured God as a big policeman with a big billy club, standing up there in the heaven with a frown on his face, getting ready to pop us on the head if we smile. That's the picture a lot of people have of God. But that's not the God of the Bible. And some people think of God as being an old man with a long gray beard on a pink cloud strumming a harp back someplace in the 19th century. Some people have a picture of just sort of an oblong blur, as a soldier told us in Canada. What kind of a picture do you have? And when this fellow asked me that, I thought about it a minute, and I said, "When I think of God, I get a picture of Jesus Christ. God has revealed himself in Christ. He is the express image of his person. The Word became flesh. God has given us the light of the knowledge of his glory in the face of Jesus Christ." And that's what it meant. It meant that if Saul was ever going to know God, he had to come to know him through Christ. But it meant something more than that. It meant that Jesus Christ was alive. He wasn't dead someplace in a tomb. He was living. And he could come and seek Saul out on this Damascus road and transform his life because he was alive. Some of us were talking today at lunch about various people who had met Christ. And I was thinking about a friend of mine that some of you know, Lane Adams, a Presbyterian minister down in Miami. Lane Adams was a naval fighter pilot. Then he became a nightclub singer. Very successful. Met a young lady who was a dancer in Las Vegas and they were married. Then he began to drink too much. Their marriage started to come apart. And one day they sat down and started to read the Bible in their hotel room in Louisville, Kentucky. And he came to the portion in the Gospel of John where Christ appeared to Thomas, the doubter. And when Thomas saw Christ, he fell on his feet and he said, "My Lord and my God." And my friend Leighton Adams turned to his wife and said, "I don't understand everything about this, but I know one thing. Jesus Christ isn't dead. He's alive someplace, and I mean to find him." He said, "Oh, Jesus Christ,
I'll follow you. You'll show me how I can find you. Christ took hold of his life, and he discovered that Christ is alive, contemporary, in 1962. Is he alive to you? Have you met him? But it meant something more than that. Not only that Christ was alive, it meant that Jesus Christ loved him. Imagine. He was persecuting Christ. He hated him. What did Christ do? He sought him out on that dusty road and said, Saul, I love you. I died for you. And in Romans 5:8, as he looked back on this experience, Paul wrote to the Romans and he said, God commendeth his love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. While we were his enemies, reconciled us by the death of his son. And the wonder of this, that God loved him, no matter what he had done, no matter what his sin had been, no matter how he was filled with hate and prejudice, God loved him just as he was and had died for him on the cross and had shed his blood. It transformed his life. Jesus Christ had died for him. Have you discovered that? And finally, that led him to an unexpected commitment. He never thought he'd come to that day. But he lay there prostrate on the ground. He saw that he needed to get right with God. He sensed his need. He found out that Christ was the Lord who had died for him and risen again. He looked up into his face and he said, Lord, what wilt thou have me to do? Have you ever said that to Christ? Christian is a man or a woman who has stopped doing what he wants to do and has started doing what Christ wants him to do. Have you said that to him? Lord, here I am. Take my mind. Take my body. Take my possessions. Take my time. Take my life. Take my home. Take my business. Take my career. Lord, what do you want me to do? You show me. I'm going to live for you. Whatever it may be, wherever it may be, as a businessman, as a housewife, as a student, in all of my life, Lord Jesus Christ, if you die for me, I'm going to live unto you for the rest of my life. Lord, what do you want me to do? And conversion means that I come to the place where I see my own need. Then I come to the place where I see that on the cross, Christ died for my sins and did what I could never do for myself and rose again. And then that I come to him and put my life into his hands and say, Lord Jesus, you died for my sins. Now I'm going to live for you. Have you said that? You may be a traditional Christian, because it's always been the tradition in your family. Church. You may be an intellectual Christian. You give intellectual assent. You say, I believe in God. I believe in Christ. I believe in the cross. I believe in the Bible. I believe in all of these things. You may be an emotional Christian. You may have had an emotional experience sometime. But have you ever come to the place where you've said with your will, Lord Jesus, what wilt thou have me to do? I accept thee as my Savior, and I crown thee as my Lord. If not, I'm going to ask you to do it tonight. There are some of you who believed intellectually, but you've never really committed your life to Christ. There are others of you tonight, there's an empty place in your life, you don't know what's wrong, but somehow you feel tonight that Christ is the only one that can fill it. I'm going to ask you tonight to let him in. He says, I stand at the door and knock. If you open the door, I'll come in. Will you let him in tonight? Some of you say, I see tonight my sin. I've been trusting in my church membership, in my good works, in the money I've given. But you say, that's not good enough. I want to come to the cross. Nothing in my hands I bring. Simply to thy cross I cling. Well, I'm going to ask you to come tonight. I believe Christ is speaking to many of you. Some of you have never received him as your Savior. Some of you aren't sure
You believed about him, but you're not positive, and you ought to settle it tonight.
Some of you have received Christ, but you've been away from him. Maybe when you were a young boy or a young girl, you need to come back to him and say, Lord, afresh tonight, I commit myself to thee. I'm going to ask you to do it.
And this is what I'm going to ask you to do.
In just a moment, we're going to bow in prayer. And the choir is going to sing. And I'm going to ask that we do something that we've seen people do by the hundreds and thousands all around the world. I'm going to ask you to get up quietly as Christ is speaking to you.
And come from the place where you're sitting.
And stand here at the front of the church. Very quietly, and very reverently, with heads bowed. Down here on the floor, facing this way. Up in the balcony, down on the main floor, in the choir, Christ may be speaking to you. You can come from there.
And as you come, you're saying this. Perhaps you say tonight, but I've never done this, or we don't do this in our church usually. You say, what does it mean? Why do you ask us to do it? Well, Christ says that we should confess him before men.
Christ hung publicly on a cross for us, and we can certainly come publicly.
Make our profession and confession of our faith in him and our commitment to him.
But when you come, Christ said, come unto me. You are coming in symbolism to the cross, not to me.
You're coming in the first place acknowledging your need, not proudly, but humbly. Saying, I come because I need Christ as my Savior. I need perhaps to rededicate my life to him as Lord.
And then you're not coming to the preacher or to the church. We're not asking you this week to join this church. We're going to ask people this week to come to Christ as Savior and Lord, and then to follow him in the church where he directs. But you're coming to the cross and to the person of Christ to say, by faith, I come to him. And this is an expression. It's a symbol of it. It's not a display. It's not a spectacle. It's an open expression of an inward commitment. Just as a man makes a promise and he shakes hands. And the handshake means, I'll keep my word. Just as a soldier sees the flag go by and in his heart he says, I'll be loyal. And he salutes. It's a sign. Just as a couple comes to the front of the church. In their hearts and privately, they've already said to each other, we commit our lives to each other. But they come and they make their vows and they kiss. As an open sign of an inward commitment.
Now that's what it means when you come. You're saying, I acknowledge that I'm coming symbolically to the cross of Christ as my Savior and my Lord. And then it means you're getting up to say, I'm going to follow him from this night on. I believe there are many of you Christ is speaking to on this first night, young man, young lady, father, mother, some of you couples, starting life together, ought to come and say we want to commit our home to Christ and let him be Lord of our home. Now, I'm not asking everybody to come. If you've never received Christ as your Savior and you say, tonight I want to do it, or you're not sure about it, you say, I want to know, I want to settle, or you may say, I've been away from Christ and I need to come and rededicate my life to him, I'm going to ask you to come. Stand at the front. Ask a friend to come and stand beside you if you want. They'll be glad to come. And after you've come, I want to have a brief word and a prayer with you and then give you some literature and Bible studies that will help you to grow and to follow Christ. Then you can rejoin your friends. But as Christ is speaking, I'm going to ask you to come. We've seen people do all over the world. And I'm going to ask that we bow in prayer. Every head bowed. This is an unexpected night for many of you. Are you sure that Christ is in your heart? Are you sure you've encountered him? Are you sure he's forgiven your sins? Are you sure you have eternal life? Has there come a time when you've asked Christ into your heart? What a harvest time this can be tonight as you come to him. I'm going to ask that we stand very quietly, with heads bowed and eyes closed. Make it easier to slip out. May we all stand quietly. Choir is going to sing this great old hymn of invitation. And as they sing, I'm going to ask you to come. Young man, some of you up there in the balcony, Christ is speaking. It may be a long way, but you come down here on the main floor, whoever you are. Just come quietly and reverently.
stand here at the front. I'll show you where to stand when you come. Say tonight, I'm going to say yes to Christ. He's speaking to you. Christians, you pray. For those around you, your prayers can help somebody to find Christ. As the choir sings, you come. If you're in the choir, you want to make your decision, let the others sing. You slip out with the others that are coming. Many of you come right now. Just step out wherever you are. That's right. That's right. Just slip out quietly. Take that first step. Come and stand quietly and reverently down here. Christ is speaking and you want to come to him tonight for the first time or in rededication. Slip out now. We're going to wait while the choir sings another stanza or two. Then the service will be through. There are others of you. Some of you couples, some of you older folk, some of you men tonight. Christ is speaking. You come. Let this be your night of decision to say yes to him. That's right. Wait just another stanza or two. You pray. Christ is calling, not because I ask, but because he asks. You come. Sight it is to see many young people who've come tonight. Some of you I know coming for the first time to really receive Christ. Some of you coming in rededication. I want to assure you of this. Christ said, him that cometh to me,
I will in no wise cast out. You haven't come to Leighton Ford. You've come to Christ. As I said earlier, you may not see him, but he's here, real. We want to have a word with you and a prayer and give you some of these Bible studies. And in order that we might do it more quietly, I'm going to ask that you that have come might slip out to our room downstairs that we're going to have for counseling, where I want to have just a brief word of prayer. I'll ask that you go out that way with the counselors, and I want to come and have a word with you. Others of you, if Christ is speaking, you come, still time. I hope that you will pray. This might only be the beginning, a foretaste of what we might see during these days. Continue to pray. Bring your friends when you come back. Don't just come to enjoy the blessing yourself. This isn't an entertainment for Christians. This is an opportunity to reach out and invite people to share with the most wonderful treasure in the world, the treasure of Christ. So you come prayerfully tomorrow morning, again tomorrow night, and believing that Christ will speak. Now we'll have the benediction. If others of you after the service is over want to come and have some further counsel to learn more about receiving Christ, we'll be glad to speak with you. One of the ushers, one of the ministers here at the front, will be glad to direct you if you'll come down. Now we'll ask the minister of the church to lead us in the benediction.
Eternal Father, we have felt thy spirit here tonight, speaking to our hearts through thy servant. We take thy word into our hearts. As the Lord Jesus becomes the Lord of all, he may have complete charge of all that we are. Thank thee for these who have come inquiring tonight. As the counselors work with them, give them discretion and tact and understanding. Throughout the week, speak, we pray, to hundreds of people here in the community, that they may come to know and to love the Lord Jesus Christ, and to serve him with all their hearts. Let us go then in the fellowship of thy presence. And as we go, let us remember that in the goodness of God we were born. In the providence of God we have been kept all the day long. In the love of God we are redeemed through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen.